say that with me. Ooh, God, my God, God is good. Yeah. Know that He brought me out of darkness. God is good. Yeah. And then He saved my soul. God is good.
Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. And that's why we're here this morning, to worship God, to praise Him in song, to hear His word proclaimed, and to communicate with Him in prayer. If you look, I want to welcome all of you, whether you're here in the auditorium with us this morning or our online audience. You're all welcome, and we're certainly glad that you're here. Before I go into the rest of the announcements, I'd like to turn this over to Byron. Where you at? There you are.
I've got a few announcements to make about one of our missions that we have here at North Tampa. It's the Mount Dora Children's Home in Mount Dora, Florida. My wife Sandy and I are their contact people here at North Tampa. And two benefits that they're now involved in. We have out in our entry coin cans that are on either side of the entry. They're on tables. Their coin can drive is now through June. And they use these funds to help the children that live on site that come from disadvantaged homes. And they also have a Christian school on the campus, a private school that a lot of the children even in Mount Dora attend. And they also have a single parent program where they provide a housing for single parents and education and counseling for both the parent and the child. And so it's an awesome mission to be involved in. And the coin cans are an excellent way if you have children at home, that you can have them use these coin cans to put in their allowance money or money that they do for odd jobs around the house, to teach them that they need to be looking to help others, that it's not all about themselves, which children today often think, that they need to look into their hearts and have a heart for serving and giving. So it's an excellent way for them to also help serve. The second thing is, for this last year, well, 2 years ago, about this time, we had a Mount Dora benefit dinner here in Tampa, and they usually have it in conjunction with a silent auction, which we were involved with. Last year, they canceled that, and they had two online virtual dinners. One went very well, one did not go quite so well because of the pandemic. This year, looking to get things back to normal, we hope, and at a time which hopefully we can get people involved again, on May 8th, they're having a benefit dinner at the Doubletree Hotel in Tampa, which is where we had our last event, at 6 p.m., and they're also having at 7 p.m., they're going to live stream it, so those who cannot attend can go onto their home site, which is mdchome.org, and they can participate in that way. And it's an excellent way for our congregation and those online who aren't in the area to help an awesome organization and to help kids in need and single parents in need. I have information out on the bulletin board for the dinner. You do need to sign up. The tickets are free, but we ask that if you sign up for a ticket, that you plan on attending and mark it on your calendar, because they have to pay for all the meals based on the number that we give them. So it's an excellent way for us to be involved. They have sponsorships for businesses from $1,000 to $500. You can also sponsor a table of 10 for $500 if as an individual you want to do that. And we just think it's an awesome way for our church to be involved in something local and something that helps children as well as single parents. And we ask that you take a look seriously at the information out on the bulletin board and contact Sandy or I. Our information's out there if you have any questions. And we thank you from Mount Dora for your continued support.
Thank you, Byron. You know, the pandemic has slowed us down in many respects in terms of our attendance here in our building and our classes and things like that. But one thing that the pandemic has not slowed down is the commitment of this congregation to good works and to doing things. Certainly, Mount Dora is an effort that we've supported for a long, long time. and we're continuing that. I look out and I see the work that's been going on by our members at places like Messengers of Hope, and I know that very quietly several of you here in the congregation recently raised over $1,000 to help Messengers of Hope with a freezer problem that they were having. We just keep moving on despite all of that. If I were to go through this bulletin and tell you about every opportunity that you have to participate in good works, Neal could just go home right now because there wouldn't be time for anything else. I know some of you have your Sunday dinner already on in the crock pot, and you've got to get home to make sure that that's okay. And so you're going to, Neal just would be out of a job today, and that's all that it would be. You guys are engaged in so many good things. Jared and Janine LeSueur have multiple opportunities for you to get out and to participate and to do good works. Jared and Janine have just, they're some of those below the surface, below the radar kind of people that just go out and do good things. And I'm glad that we were able to advertise some of that here this morning. Mount Dora, our own Gary Stevens is sponsoring an ALS walk that will be a walk for ALS on May 1st at 9:45. We encourage everybody to participate in that and to help support Gary as we try to find a cure for this dreadful disease, ALS. We also have our ladies' class that Jesse Turner is going to restart on April 8th at 10 a.m., and we certainly encourage you to be involved in all of that. Like I said, if I tried to read all of this to you, it would be here forever. The psalmist tells us in Psalm 118:24 that today is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Orlando?
There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus singing, no, not one. We're singing, no, not one. And none else could hear all our soul diseases singing, no, not one. We're singing, no, not one. And you know Jesus knows all about our struggles. You know that he will guide till the day is done. And well, there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus singing, no. We're singing, no, not one. And there's not an eye that he is not near us. Singing, no, not one. We're singing, no,
not one. And no, my soul done, but his love can cheer us. Singing, no, not one. We're singing, no, not one. And you know Jesus knows all about our struggles. You know that he will die till the day is
This morning we're reading from Romans 13, 1 through 8. And this is going to be a tough lesson, Neal. I can't wait to hear this. So Romans 13, 1 through 8. Everyone must submit himself to the government governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear of one in authority? Then do what is right, and he will commend you. For he is God's servant to do you good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword for nothing. He is God's servant, an agent of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also because of conscience. This is also why you pay taxes, for the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give everyone what you owe him. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another, for he who loves his fellow man has fulfilled the law. Pray with me. Lord, there are some passages in the Bible that are tougher to hear at different times in our lives, Lord God. I pray that you would guide us as we listen to Neal and prepare our hearts to hear what he has to say for this. This is government right now is a tough subject for a lot of people to hear and talk about, Lord God. We've been had a very tough few years, and I pray that you would just help our attitudes as Christians to align with this passage, Lord God. I pray that you would be with us and prepare us again to hear this. Be with us for the rest of this week. In your name, amen.
And turmoil if you listen to the news. That's why I try not to. But in this country, it seems like there's events happening all the time. The lines have been drawn. There's all kinds of organizations out there. And, I'm not despairingly trying to tear down anything here, but, Me Too, Can't, Cancel. I mean, it's almost getting to the preposterous ridiculous. Mounted people are in tension. We see people that are deeply wounded and deeply angry and divided. And perhaps more than any other time, do we not need this memorial that we come to every Sunday? And reminder that this meal is a purpose. It seems that we're living in almost in a broken world, a fallen people in a fallen world. A world that needs justice and righteousness for sure, peace, and some light, some shining light. Look around our society at the division of anger and yelling, screaming, distrust. It's almost there's lines being drawn in the sand saying it's us against them. But there was one who came to erase these lines and give us a shining light that we so need. The way it was meant to be for us to have a shining light. In this meal that we gather together as one bond, as one family, representing the world in which Christ was crucified on that cross, that he took the love of the world on his shoulders. The story of Jesus, as you know, is probably a very simple one. He was born in a manger and in a carpenter's family and as a son of God. He ended in death and rose again in our everlasting glory as a redemption of our sins. It is only through Jesus that we can cut down this division and this strife and these lines, and we can be bond together for everlasting. And he did this in the forgiveness of our sins. He didn't have to, but he needed to, and he wanted to. Paul tells a church in Corinth that when they shared this meal, that they were participating in the body and blood of Christ and the sacrifice that he gave us. And through that, we have an opportunity to live forever. God told us that he did not send his son to save the world, but through the world might be saved through him. And I am going there to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you can be there also. So when we gather together to share this cup and this loaf, we are sharing the redemption of our sins on that cross that Christ led. Shall we pray? Our dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you this morning, and as we come to the date coming up on that cruel cross where your son died for our sins and then rose again, significance that we can have everlasting life through his sacrifice. We just pray, Heavenly Father, that this loaf that we take this morning, that we might be worthy of it. In Christ we do pray. Amen. And take a little cellophane off. Shall we pray for the cup? Our dear Heavenly Father, as we come to, again, to pray for the cup of the blood that you had shed, the redemption of our sins, we just pray again that we might be worthy of this cup and keep us focused on our everyday life that on the cross. In Christ we pray. Amen. Now, at the part of the service in which we have to give back of our wonderful bounty that we are gracious enough to been given to us through our hard work or whatever, and we give a little bit back. We have two baskets on each side up here, or you can go online. But it's for us to give back a little bit to the church and to his kingdom, that we may continue to strive to do his will. Shall we pray? Oh, Heavenly Father, as we come to you again, we just pray, Heavenly Father, that the finances that we have here that may be used to further your kingdom while we're here. In Christ we do pray. Amen.
If you're ever standing this morning, we'll sing a song before we ever do that. But I'll let you pass your class. When I was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. Well, I had a little light from heaven to fill my soul.
Jesus makes it right. Oh, Good morning, church. I tell you what, after that kind of singing right there, I don't know what's wrong with some of you people. I turned around and looked, and some of you are in the spirit, and some of you are lost. I can tell by the look on your face, you are not with us today. But I want to welcome everybody that's here. I want to thank you for being here. If you're online, we appreciate you being here online with us today. This is going to be the sermon that is going to cause me the most grief of any sermon that I have ever preached. I know this already. As a matter of fact, as I was preparing this sermon this week, I was thinking to myself, I should not have done this, because it's going to cause problems for you, which means I'm going to have problems. Here's the thing. Everything about what we're going to be talking about today is counterintuitive. But if you go back to Romans 12, the passages we've been looking at for the last several weeks, everything about that is counterintuitive. But we live in a time where we are divided, as Bill was talking about. I got to tell you, some funny things happen to me. I don't talk politics with a lot of people. I mostly listen to their political views. The reason being is I have learned in my old age that if I want to argue with somebody, I just give them a different side of a political view. It's so funny because I, like I said, I don't talk to people, and I had this person was talking to me, and I was talking about another person I knew. And they, you know, I said, you know such and such, I'm friends with them. And they looked at me and they said, just as serious as they could be, you know he's a Democrat. Yeah. What's really funny, though, is not 3 weeks later, I had somebody come to me. And I was talking about somebody else and said, hey, you know them? Yeah, I know them. You know he's a Trump supporter. What is that? These are members of the body of Christ, and we're defining them by their political views? That's not what should be. Now, I have my own political views. You have your own political views, and those are all great, but they should not divide us. And Paul writes something very interesting here. He writes in this, he says, everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities. If you have your pencil or your pen, underline those words. Because I want you to know that there are people in the church here and abroad that will not submit to certain authorities. And the Bible says if you're going to be a Christ follower, you need to submit to authority. Now that's so counterintuitive to us who live in the United States, because we're a democracy. We get to vote for who we want in. Amen? But guess what? Our guy didn't win, or our guy did win, depending on which side you're on. Sometimes it's easy to submit when your guy wins, but it's not so easy to submit when your guy loses. So look at this. I want you to see, there's two definitions. First of all, I went to the Greek, and I looked this up, and I did the study on the Greek word, and you know the word everyone there means everyone. It doesn't mean everyone but me. As a matter of fact, you can see I've got the side note. Everyone means everyone, which includes me. You're not exempt. I want you to know everyone means everyone. Second thing I want you to do is I want you to understand to submit means to obey. And in this case right here, it means to be a good citizen. It just means that you're going to follow. Now, I want you to understand something. Submission is such a problem for us today. Nobody wants to submit to anybody. The Bible teaches about submitting to your rulers as here. He talks about submitting to your elders. He's talking about wives submitting to your husbands. But he also says in that same passage in verse 21, submit to one another. And nobody wants to submit these days. But let me say this to you. It is a requirement of God that we submit to each other, to our spouse, and to our government, and to our spiritual leaders. And when we learn that idea and realize it is a Christian, Bible-based idea, we're going to be a lot happier. Now, I've had women tell me when they're getting married, the last verse they want used in their wedding is that idea of husbands submitting to their wives. And it's been misused for so many years. I'm the man of the house. You've got to do what I say. You know what they don't realize is that passage also says, husbands, love your wife as Christ loved the church. If husbands were to love their wives as Christ loved the church, there wouldn't be any problems with women submitting. And that's therein is the problem there. So submit means to obey, and you need to understand this whole idea of biblical submission, if you'll open up your notes, is neither blind nor absolute, but it's always respectful. Biblical submission is neither blind nor absolute, but it's always respectful. And I want you to look at this in Acts chapter 4 and verse 18, because there are times when the government will ask you to do things that you're not supposed to do. And Peter and John had been arrested there before the Sanhedrin, and they're told, hey, look, we're going to beat you, and we don't want you to go out anymore and preach the gospel. And here in a very respectful way, Peter and John say, then they called them in again, commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, judge for yourselves whether it is right in God's sight to obey you rather than God, for we cannot speak about what we have seen. We cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard. I just brushed my teeth. I can't do a thing with them. I've been studying the book of Daniel, getting ready for a series of classes I hope to teach, and so this has just kind of just jumped out at me. In the book of Daniel, you may remember the Old Testament story. If you grew up in Bible classes, you'll remember the story about Shadrach, and I need to go. Replied to the king, he says, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves from you in this matter. If we're thrown into a blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O king. Underline those words because they're being respectful. But even if he does not, we will want you to know, O king, again, he's being respectful, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up for us. You see, in this, they are being defiant, but they are being respectful to the king. They're not trying to overthrow his government. They're not trying to go in and take over. They're being respectful, but they're also following God first. Just like the disciples said, whether it's right to obey God or man. And then Daniel later on, you know the story, but Daniel had this situation where all of the people around him hated him. He was trusted by the king. They went through his expense reports, couldn't find anything wrong with Daniel whatsoever. They did all this work trying to find him. They said, one way we can trap him is Daniel prays every day to his God. So if we get the king to come up with this idea that no one can pray to God or any gods or man except for the king for this period of time, we'll trap Daniel and Daniel will be put to death. So they got the king to put this decree together, and guess what? Daniel decided that it would be wrong for him if he quit praying towards Jerusalem every day in an open window. So he continued doing. Now, there was no law that said he had to pray towards Jerusalem or he had to do it in an open window, because it was his practice and he was showing who he respected most. He continued to do it. He continued
to follow his faith. But guess what happens? The king's decree was there. These officials came and got Daniel. They brought him before the king. You said, you're going to put to death anybody that prays to anybody other than you. And he's been praying to his God. We got witnesses. Here it is. And you've got to kill him now. And the king looked for a way out and couldn't find it. And for those of you who were in Bible school, you remember the story. They put Daniel in the lion's den, and God held them at bay until the next morning. And the king comes running, and he looks in the cage, and he says, Daniel, Daniel, are you okay? Did your God save you? My response would have been, you idiot, why did you put me in the cage? But look at what Daniel says. Daniel says, O king, live forever. He is so respectful of the man that put him in the lion's cage. I want you to get that. The second thing I want you to get when it comes to government and things is there are two kinds of people. There are rule followers and there are rule breakers. There's rule followers and there are rule breakers. Now, I want you, those of you who know me pretty well, I want you to guess which one I am. It's not hard to guess, is it? I'm a rule breaker. I think rules were made to be broken. I feel like if there's a way around a rule, let's figure it out. Now, some of you are the complete opposite. Some of you are rule followers. You want to get it right. You want to get it down to the T. And the problem with that is that's your personality, just like it's my personality. But you can take it to an extreme, okay? And you know, there are people that take the rules to an extreme. If you've ever lived in a neighborhood with an HOA, you know what I'm talking about. We have this thing in my neighborhood. You can only have your trash cans out on certain days when they're picking up the trash can. One Wednesday night before I came to church, I pulled my trash cans out because it was going to be dark when I got home, and Nancy was going to be asleep, and I didn't want to bother her. So I took my trash cans and I put them down by the side of the road. And guess what? The next day I got a letter. And guess what I did? I tore it up. And I was supposed to respond. And thus, guess what happened next? I got a certified letter. And so I called them and I said, what's your problem? And they explained to me, these are the rules and you have to follow them. So now, every night, Wednesday night, when I get home and it's dark, I very quietly roll my trash cans down to the edge of the road, hoping nobody in the HOA is there to see me, because I'm supposed to do it at 6 o'clock in the morning before they come get them. Rules are made to be broken. Now, here's the other side of it. Some of you are such rule followers, and I that's just the way God made you. I love you. But for me, speed limits are more of a suggestion than they are a hard, fast rule. Okay, I'm just confessing here. You can call me a sinner. That's what I am. But some of you, if the speed limit is 35, you're going to drive 30 because you don't want to get anywhere close. And all you do is irritate the rest of us. You see what I'm saying? Now, when it comes to extremes in government, you need to understand that. Some of you, because you're a rule follower, you're going to get extreme on things, and some of you are going to like, it doesn't matter, we're going to do whatever we want. And you, under the guise of being a Christian, need to bring your personality under control so that you're doing what is right. See, here's the reason. The truth you need to know about this passage
in every other passage of Scripture here is that the goal is to advance the gospel. Our goal is to advance the gospel. It is not to advance one party over another. It is to advance the gospel. You know what? Our goal is not even to save the United States. It is to save the world. Our goal is not to save our standard of living and our way of life. Our goal is to advance the gospel. And when we understand that, we can submit to these authorities. Look at what I've got here in 1 Peter chapter 2, 11 through 17. You got to see it in context. Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers. Underline those words. Because everybody in this room is an illegal alien today. You're an illegal alien today. I'm just telling you. You don't belong to this world, and you're here illegally when you look at the world. You're a stranger. It says, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans. You say, some of you are saying, I'm not an illegal alien. I was born here. You're living among pagans. Look at what it says. Underline it. Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day He visits us. That is your goal right there. That is the reason why you do good. That's the reason why I put my trash cans out Wednesday night late instead of during the day. Because I want to live such a good life that the pagans may accuse me of putting my trash cans out at the wrong time, but I'm going to do it anyway. See what I'm saying here? Look at what it says next. It says, submit yourself for the Lord's sake, and underline these words, to every authority instituted among men. You know, one of the most interesting things to me, as soon as Trump was elected, they started this hashtag, not my president. And guess what? As soon as Biden was elected, they went back to it and not my president again. But look at what it says here. Submit yourself for the Lord's sake to every authority among men, whether to the kings as supreme authority or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will. How many of y'all in here want to know what God's will? It says it right here. It is God's will that by doing good, you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish men. Live as free men, but do not use your freedom as a cover for evil. Live as servants of God. Show proper respect for everyone. Love the brotherhood of believers. Fear God and honor the king. If you're going to live as a Christian, you need to understand that you're doing these things not because of the person, but you're doing them because God put them in authority. This is so full of scripture. I should have put this in a two-part sermon, I'm going to tell you right now, but I was scared to because I know I am going to get some emails over this. And let me just say this right here. Folks, we live in a democracy, but that same democracy voted in whoever's in charge at that moment. And some of you are going to probably say, like I have said, but what about the American Revolution? We wouldn't be where we are today if it wasn't for those men that fought for our freedom. I'm like, I struggle with that too. But I'm going to tell you what God's Word says, not what the American Revolution is about. Because if those men weren't following God's will, that's between them and God. And I have to do what I can do today. 2 Timothy 2, 1 through 4, I urge you then, first of all, that requests and prayers and intercession and thanksgiving be made for everyone. And
Look at what it says next. For kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. You see, the purpose behind us being good citizens, the purpose behind us supporting whoever's in office and following their authority, the purpose of all of that is so that all men might be saved and come to a knowledge of God. That's our walking papers. Now, I'm not saying here if you have a political party that you support and you want to support them and give money to them, I think that's fine. If you want to go out and fundraise for them, I think that's fine. If you want to go out and you want to put out banners in your yard, I think that's fine. That's all good. But when God decides the election, and I want you to understand that right now, because I have family members that think the election was stolen. When God decides an election, it's done. And there may be criminal things going on, I don't know. There may be subversive things going on, I don't know. But I know who's in control. And it is God, and we are to submit, even if the person is evil. And the reason why I want you to see this is because Paul wrote this in the time that the Roman government was in charge. They were the very people that crucified Jesus. And they are the very ones that later on will kill Paul. And they are the very ones that were crucifying, burning at the stake other Christians. And Paul says, yes, I know they're an evil government, but you need to submit to them. And by submitting to them and being a good citizen, you're going to change them. Look at what I got in your notes. We are to eliminate conflict and turn hostility into respect and apathy into interest. We need to do those things in order to change the world, in order to save the world. Now, your second point, I've kind of already made it, but I want to make it again. God is in control of who is in control. God is in control of who is in control. A lot of times we think, oh, my vote, that's what's going to make the difference, and it does make a difference. But it is God who is in control of what goes on. And I think peaceful protesting is a great way to do it. Letters to your congressmen is a great way to do things. But you need to understand that God is in control of who is in control. Everyone must submit himself to governing authorities. For there is no authority except that which God has established. The authority that exists have been established by God. Do you notice he says that twice? Because you know why? Because some of you are not getting it the first time. Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against the government. No, you're rebelling against what God has instituted. And those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. Reading Daniel chapter 2 and verses 20 through 21, I just pulled this out of there. You can go back and look at the whole verse. He sets up kings and he deposes them. He sets up kings and he deposes them. And here I got your new note, and this is something you need to know as Americans, as citizens of this United States. Ultimately, a nation gets what it deserves. Ultimately, a nation gets what it deserves. Folks, I'm here to tell you, you want to change this nation? Let's build this church. Those of you who are upset about people coming from other countries illegal in here, let's get some mission teams down there to show them how to live like Christ. Those of you who are upset about people taking advantage of the systems we got in place, let's convert them and show them integrity.
Let's quit complaining about them and trying to prosecute them and persecute them, and let's show them the love of Christ. If this nation falls, it will be because of the church, not because of our leaders. And until we, as members of Christ's body, go out and get as passionate as we are our political affiliation, the world's not going to change. And ultimately, this nation will not be what it once was. Number three, we must honor the position, not the person. We must honor the position and not the person. In Acts chapter 23, verses 1 through 11, the high priest, Ananias, ordered those standing near Paul to strike him on the mouth. And then Paul said to him, God will strike you, you whitewashed walls. You sit there in judgment. And judge me in accordance to the law, yet you yourselves violate the law by commanding that I be struck. Those who were standing there near Paul said, you dare insult God's high priest? Paul's reply is, brothers, I did not realize that he was the high priest, for it is written, do not speak evil about the rulers of your people. I want those of you who are unhappy with what's going on in this world right now to underline those words, do not speak evil about the rulers of your people. Underline those words. It doesn't sit well, it doesn't feel right, but underline those words. You see, I don't have Facebook. I tell everybody I don't have the face for it. Actually, I don't have the time for it. First of all, if I'm on Facebook, I'm going to become friends with the members of this church, and I'm going to spend all of my days correcting you what you put out on Facebook. Because some of you put things out on Facebook that are so vile and so nasty that incite division in the church that if I was in charge of Facebook, I'd wipe out your account. And some of you are using Facebook for what it to encourage and things like that. But you need to understand this verse right here. Do not speak evil about the rulers of your people. And what I'm saying here is if you have a complaint, you can make a complaint. But if you are just spreading dirt, don't do it anymore. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 24 through 26. And the Lord's servant must not quarrel. Oh, man, half of this church needs to underline those words. Look at that. The Lord's servant must not quarrel. That includes Facebook. That includes emails. Don't send me your political stuff. Instead, he must be kind to everyone. I knew this sermon was not going to go over well. I can tell by the looks on your face. You must be kind to everyone. And why? So that you can be able to teach and not resentful. Man, does that not hurt? Those who oppose him have different political views. Those who oppose him must gently instruct in hope that God will grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth, and that they may come to their senses and escape the trap of the devil who is taking them captive to do his will. Remember Romans chapter 12 and verse 1. We are to offer our bodies as living sacrifices. You remember that part? And then it goes on to say, do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. If you leave here today with the same thoughts you have about government and the way you are angry about what's going on, then you are not being transformed by the renewing of your mind. God gave us His Word to teach us how to live and how to handle any and every situation, and especially His Word is clear on how we should have the right relationship with our government.
It's counterintuitive. It doesn't sit well with me. I'm going to confess, this whole mask thing has irritated me to no end. I don't agree with it. I don't like it. I know some of you think it's the best thing that ever happened, but I don't like it. I want to see your face. And I'm losing my hearing. I can't read your lips anymore. This is hard on me. But I'm going to wear that mask as long as those in authority say I need to. Because I respect the position. Now let me just say this. I am not a Republican. I'm not a Democrat. I'm not an independent, and I'm not a libertarian. I have leanings in those ways in terms of political views, but my identification is that I am a Christ follower. First and foremost, that's the reason why when somebody wants to talk to me about their political views, I listen kindly and smile. I may not agree with them, but I hope that my gentleness and my friendship and my relationship with them will bring them closer to Christ, because as a Christ follower, as a passionate follower of Jesus Christ, my Lord, my ultimate goal is to bring others to Him, not to change people's minds about who they voted for. And if you're here in the audience today and you spend more time preaching politics than you do teaching about Christ, it's a day to repent. And I think in this divided world, as Bill was talking about, with all the different things that are going on in today, with different movements and all those things, I think it's more than ever that we make a decision to follow Christ today. There's an old Bob Dylan song, and it says, everybody's going to follow somebody. Everybody is going to follow somebody. Everybody is going to serve somebody. And my question for you today as we close out this service, who are you serving? And what are you following? The lesson is yours as we stand and sing.
Yeah. Please bow with me for closing prayer. Lord, thank you for allowing us to be here gathered with you today in person and online, Lord. Help us to go about our way and reflect back on Neal's lesson and be the conduit for the change that the world needs today. Help those that are sick and keep your hand on us as we go our way. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.